Welcome back. This is not Module 4. This is Module 5. I'm here with Uni. I'm Jerry, and we're talking about XAML development. We've just talked about all the tooling inside Visual Studio. Then we talked about all the tooling inside Blend. Now we're going to try and put it all together in a real app that we can build soup to nuts all the way from the beginning with no tricks, right? No magic, no extra code. Isn't that the worst when you're watching a demo and they get something done and right before they do, they drag in about 6,000 lines of code and say, now you would just fill this in, and then it's terrible. We're not going to do any of that. There are there's a line or two that I could get wrong and I've got it as a snippet, but we won't do anything we don't actually walk
and we'll
through.
Explain what those lines are.
We will explain what those lines are, and it's just one or two rather than a million. And this will be one of those apps that hopefully you'll be able to take the simple data that we're writing and translate it into your real data, right? Obviously, we're going to use colors as our sample data, and you probably wouldn't in yours. All right, so there's no slides to show. We'll go straight into building. I'll go to Visual Studio. As a reminder to everybody, we have all the code that we're writing, including the code I'm about to write right now, up on xaml.codeplex.com. That's where you can go get it. We're checking it in between every session, all the changes that we make, so you can see those as well. This is the Module 5, so it's in the Module 5 folder. There are two projects already in there, one complete, one incomplete. So the complete is where I'm headed, and the incomplete is a blank. So we'll start from scratch there. Okay, this is where we are. Awesome. And a neat feature I can do inside Visual Studio is scope to a specific project. And so I can right-click and I can say scope to this. Now I don't see all my other projects right now. All right, because I click everything so fast. All right. This is the way my main page looks. Hopefully it's just blank. Yeah, it is. All right, so the first thing I would do is build a view model that I would go through and start to use. So let's create a few folders. The first would be the views. I would probably have my main page inside a views page and all the other pages I would have from then as well. I would go in and probably change its namespace, but for this sake, it doesn't really matter. I'll create another folder where the view models would go. And finally, I'll create another where all the models will go. And so the difference between a view model and a model is a view is intended to bring all the models together intended for a specific view. Or the view model brings the models together for the view. So it should actually, I always thought, be called view, view model, model. But that I didn't name it. All right. It doesn't flow quite as nicely either. I'll create a quick class that we're going to have here for models. The first one will be the thing, it will be the color. Color info right here. Color info will be a simple enough model that will hold a color, C-O-L-O-R, and we'll just call it color as well. And so the color that we're going to have, I'll use Windows.UI. We'll create another one. This will hold the name of the color. Oops, it'll be a string type. Yeah. And then the final one I'll actually implement. It'll be a solid color brush. And we'll call that brush. And so I'll have to also add here the XAML media. And here, I'll go ahead and implement it. It'll be simple enough to return a new solid color brush, passing in this.color as its base color. So that's just so we can use it easy in the XAML. It's not just a color. We can just reference the brush directly. All right, that's our first model. So this would be an example that you might use a user info or something like that if you weren't using colors. Now, I'll group those together inside another class. We'll call it group info just for the sake of everything being named similarly. And I'll make it public so I can use it. And it'll have a property of string name, so they'll be named. And then I'll also have an array of colors. So we'll say prop color info. That's the class that we just created, and we'll call it color. So two things inside the group. It'll have the name, and it'll have its colors. So now I'll go into my view model. I'll create a brand new view model here. Don't really need very much functionality inside our view model, so we'll call it the main page view model. And we'll have a single property, at least here at the beginning, of an observable collection of type groups. So it's a collection of groups, basically. So remember, that's called models.groupInfo is what we're going to do. We'll call that groups is the name of the property. And so just to look at that more clearly, it is a is a public observable collection of group infos. Now, the reason we use observable collection here instead of, say, an array or something more primitive is because an observable collection has all of those events that that the XAML framework already looks for, so that if I add and remove groups from this collection, the UI is updated with it. So that's great because I can keep the logic in my view model, update this groups any way that I need to, and know that the UI is tracking along with me and I don't have to talk to the UI directly. Very important. All right, so just so you can see, it's just right here, just instantiates a brand new observable collection into the member, and then that's what we pass back as the read-only property. That's it for there. I will create a quick constructor. This is where I can use some sample data. So I'm going to create, I'm not going to use our sample data. I'm going to actually do some specific data here. So I'll say using system.reflection. So allow me to reflect back into the colors. So here's the colors class. I'm just doing that so I can add these types before I start using them. And so I'll get all the colors that the framework will give me out of the box. I'll go ask for that using reflection into the colors type. So I'll just say colors equals, it's going to be type of colors, and I can say get runtime properties. And so get runtime properties goes and gets all the static properties of the colors class. If I were to jump to an F12 to the colors class, you can see every color is actually a static property. This is not an enumerable. So it's a little bit special and differently implemented in WinRT. So I'll get all those properties and I'll select them then. And selecting them allows me to there's a word that allows me to do. What's that where you restructure the way it's shaped? It doesn't matter. So I'll say, I'll create a little lambda here, and it's going to be in the back of my mind now the whole time. New models.colorInfo right there. Shape? It doesn't matter. And all right. So what's happened here? Here are all the properties that it got. It brought it back as an enumerable that I can select against using link. Here I'm selecting them, and I'm selecting them as a color info that doesn't have any of its properties set. So the first property I'll set is the name. The name is just going to be the same name as the property, just x.name. That x references the property in this case. And now I want to get the property value, which is color. I'll make sure that I cast that back to color. As soon as I get it, it'll come back as object. And so I'll say x.getValue. Because that's static, I don't have to pass in a context, so I can just say null, and it'll go get the value as that static value, cast it as color, and bring it back. So now colors is going to be filled with an enumerable, not of properties, but an enumerable of these color info. So that's just our sample data. Hopefully that makes sense. So the first thing I'll do is I'll create groups. We'll create 4 or 5 groups, and let's do it like this. I'll say this.groups.add new group info, new models. I want to add the using for that because it's getting long here. Group info. So again, we haven't even gotten to the XAML. This is just the view model behind the scenes here working for us. And so there's my group info. The name is going to be group one, let's say. That's fine. And then the colors equal. And then now I'm going to pull out just a few from the colors. I'll say, let me scroll over to the right so it doesn't feel like I'm losing it here. Colors, and I'll say take, or let's skip first, skip 0, take 5. So that allows me, I'm basically starting at the beginning, and I just did that skip like that so we can see them all kind of side by side. And then the last thing is to make sure that it's an array and not just any enumerable. So now that I'll create my first group, it'll have a property of colors that'll be filled with the first 5 of those colors. So I skipped 0, which means I begin at the beginning, and I take the next 5. So that's just a nice feature. So let me do that 1, 2, 3, 4. I'll create 5 quick groups, and we'll say group 2, 3, 4, and 5. And then all I need to do is skip a few more. So I'll say first one I'll skip 5 and then take 5. The next one I'll skip 10, then 15, and then 20. So each of them will at least have different colors, if nothing else. You wouldn't do this way. You would group all of your users by geographic region, or you would, you know, all these other ways that you would group your data by.
Jerry, we promise no magic. And someone, to keep our promise, somebody's asking, how did you create that observable collection by just typing a single letter?
Oh, so perhaps that was, maybe that was just a little magic and I didn't think about it. If you type prop and you hit double tab, that'll create the most basic way of creating a property inside C#. That's just type prop and then double tab. Now, that's because it's using a snippet from the snippet manager. You can create a snippet.
Out of the box, under Studio, Visual Studio has a lot of snippets.
Everybody has that. Or you can, and you can go in and you can look exactly how that's done, and you might create one called prop observable yourself, right? Just like I did. I copied prop, I created prop observable, and when you double tab that, instead of having just the basics, it has an observable collection instead.
Yeah, just to summarize, like we discussed at the beginning of the day, XAML also has snippets. We pretty much take the same idea, share the same idea with C#. You kind of declare the snippet in the exact same way. You have parameters that the user can tab into to replace.
Yeah.
It so happens that Jerry, to save a bunch of typing, created a snippet that he installed on his machine.
Yeah, totally. In fact, let me just go ahead and show where that is. I go to my, not downloads, but documents. Go to Visual Studio 2013. Go to code snippets. This was a C# code snippet. Here's my code snippets. I've got a handful of them right here, including a basic view model. And here are the here's the prop observable. If I were to open this up in Visual Studio, it's a pretty simple layout. And so here it is. I just typed in the way I always do observable collections.
Great.
Saved me a lot of time. All right, good. I'm glad you jumped in with that because that's a pretty cool thing. I feel like every developer should have a snippet like that. And so all those custom ones were ones that I've written over time. I'm just tired of typing the same thing over and over and over. All right, great. I'm going to hit F6 so this builds. And I'm going to open up the main page now inside Blend. So here I am in Blend. It doesn't have a reference to the view model yet, so I'll need to create all of that. I will, we'll go at the page level. And if I go to the properties dialog, you can see that the data context is still blank. I can use the new button here to create that initial instantiation or reference to it. And so I'll say new. It'll scope down just to what's inside my assembly so I don't see a bunch of other gibberish and only the things that can actually apply. So here's that main page view model. I'll say go, and if I were to use the split view, you could see that they did basically what you would have typed inside Visual Studio, just setting the data context to this complex value of main page view model, and it set up my namespace for me. Pretty nice, actually. So there's nothing else to do. Now, from this point forward, because data context is a dependency property, it flows down the hierarchy and is inherited in every control from this point forward. So I can go in and I can say, now what do I want to add to the base grid? I'll use this data tab. So in the data tab, I can see the data context right here at the bottom is already set for me. There's that groups property, the one and only property in our view model right now. I can open that up and I can see kind of how it's built. So an individual group now has a collection of colors. And remember, a color has a brush, color, and name. Well, here's the colors. If I were to drag the groups over, it's pretty nice. If I were to drag the groups over, it knows I'm wanting to see this as some sort of data repeater. And so a group is, this is not grouped, it's just groups. It's a single one-level collection. This, on the other hand, is grouped by the groups collection here. So if I were to drag groups only, it would be a simple grid view that it creates. And there they are, all the different groups. You can kind of see it says group 1, group 2, group 3, group 4, and group 5, the three that we created. So I'm going to go ahead and undo what I just did. That's the way it would happen if I dragged groups. But I'm going to drag colors. And because colors is a child, it'll know that it's intended to be groups. So I'll drag that over. And as soon as I do, it creates it. No, wait just a second. Moving nice and fast. All right, there we go. All I did there was I did a Control-Shift-B just to make sure I pushed it in there to do it. But what's great about it is this is a lot of effort that I don't have to go through. I know how to group a grid view fine, but the reality is I don't know if I know the syntax by heart, so I'd have to go and probably look it up just to make sure I got it right. Because I grabbed this in and dragged it, it knew what I wanted to do, or at least assumed what I wanted to do. In this case, it was correct. Went ahead and created the group style that I needed, created that default group header that I wanted, and a default template as well. So it's really nice. It just kind of lays it all out the way I would hopefully do it. Now, if I want to go in and tweak it, which I do, I'll right-click here, and I'll say, inside this grid view, I want to edit the additional templates, the item-generated template. That's the item template, the item-generated template, the one that's repeated for every item, and say edit current like we were before. This allows me to edit it right here in context. You can see the layout over here. It created a border, and inside that border, it gave me an image. Just an assumption that I probably have an image. I really don't. So I'll delete both the image and the border. So here's the border. I'll go ahead and delete it, and it'll delete its child as well. Now, the other thing I'll do is the grid here is transparent. It's not doing anything for me. And so I'll go to the properties of that, and I can, oh, I don't have to go to the, well, I'll go to the properties of it. And I can see that the background has no brush. I'm going to go ahead and go to create a data binding, pulls up the nice create data binding dialog, shows the context of the data that I'm in right now. I'm going to select this brush, the solid color brush that we have inside color info, to be the background. And so as soon as I do, you can see all of this had that data, you just couldn't see it before. Pretty cool. Right here, I can see that these are already set. I don't need the subtitle, I just need the main one. And so now I've got a nice layout. It's a little bit big, so let me go back to grid. I'll change the size to be a little bit smaller with a width of
100.
100, let's say? Yeah, and a height of 200. Then I can, no, that's still way too gigantic. Let's, how about another 100? That's fine. Perfect. Let's make it a width of 200. Then it's kind of feels a little bit better as well. All right. So they're all laid out nicely for me. If I were to zoom out a little, you can see they're all grouped the way you would hope and look the way. I mean, it's just fantastic. It's great. Now, in order to make a grid view look the way you want it, you're going to want to move it down and move it to the right. Of course, you don't want to actually move it down and move it to the right because the scroll bar is going to be in a funny place. It's the padding inside that you want to make changes to. So I'll go ahead and select. I'll jump back up in context over here in Objects and Timeline. Select that grid view and go down to its properties. So I don't have to find it. I'll just type PADD so I find the padding. I'm going to change its left to be, I think it's probably about 120. And I'll give it a top padding of probably 140. There you go. That's probably where I want it to start anyway. So here I have the grid view. You can see the whole layout, but that's not good enough. I want to kind of show it the way you would do a real app. If I were to show you my start menu, here's my start menu. This is what we just created, but I want to create this idea of backing up and using semantic zoom so I can see this from another level. So semantic zoom is pretty handy as far as being able to see your data at a 50,000 foot view. So you have a zoomed in and a zoomed out view. So here I am at the grid. This is my entire app sitting with a grid view. So what I'll do is I'll add a semantic zoom. It'll be inside my assets here. I'll look for it called semantic. You can see it's right there, semantic zoom. An easy control to implement. I'll drag it right here next to the grid view. And if I open that up, sort of how the command bar is done, showing the primary and secondary buttons, it has the zoomed in, the zoomed out view, which actually don't exist at all. You know, it just kind of presets those for me. This grid view would be the zoomed in view. And so I'm going to go ahead and take this, and I'm going to drag it into the zoomed in view. So now zoomed in view is the grid view, and zoomed out is something that doesn't exist yet. And I want the zoomed out view really needs to be a grouping, or not an ungrouped list of all of the groups. And so the best way to do that is kind of how we did at the beginning. I can go over to semantic zoom, let's say. I can go to the data tab. I can see its data context is set to be groups just like before, no change because it's at the page level. I can grab and drag the groups now instead of grabbing and dragging the colors. And when I do, I can go right here to, well, I'll start up here at the grid, and it'll say, if you drop it right here, it'll create a grid view, and the item source will be bound to groups, right? So that's an ungrouped grid view. So I'll go ahead and do that. It adds it at the bottom, and I'll just drag it up and make it the zoomed out view. So I have the zoomed in view and the zoomed out view. And you can see zoomed out still looks the way we thought it would before. And let me make a few small changes. The first, I want to edit the template so that it has the color and you can kind of recognize what's going on. So let me do edit the generated item, edit the current. So you can see its layout is almost exactly the same, only it's side by side. I'm going to go ahead and delete the border and the image. Actually, let me save that. I'll just delete the image in this case. And we'll make it so I change the background of the border to bind to. But remember, a group doesn't have a color. So what are we going to bind to? Well, you can see the data context on the right-hand side still shows you that this is group info. But it shows you something interesting, not only the name and the colors, but if I open up colors, it shows me that it allows me to pick the first color. Is that right? Yeah, first color brush. First color brush. I expected to open this and see that it allowed me to do the first color brush.
No, but you don't, it's only a group, right?
It is.
So.
I thought that it would allow me to pick the first color. Well, let's go ahead and try it, right? So I'll change, I'm really thinking about this. Oh, you know what? Let's do it from the properties dialog. It will do it that way. So right now, what I have selected is the border. I'll hit F4 by mistake because I'm not in Visual Studio. I will hit un-F4. There we are. I will go over to the properties dialog, and take away padding, B-A-D-D. And all I want to do is change the background brush of the currently selected border. And so when I say background brush right here, I say create right here, open up colors, and it allows me to go to the first item. Now, I could manually change this, so I go to the second item or whatever, but I know the ordinal position is 0, and I can go to the brush of the first color info. So if I say OK to that, here it is all colored, not showing the color of the group, but instead showing the color of the first item in that group. It's nice just to give me something, so it's more than just a word. And I can go zoom in just a little, take out that subtitle that I know I won't need, go to the group itself, change its font size just a little so it's a little bit more useful, let's say maybe 20, and then take the stack panel that it's in, which is currently stretched top to bottom, and just say, don't stretch that top to bottom, but right here, change its vertical alignment so that it's centered. So now it's a little bit nicer, looks a little bit more like groups. Now, if I wanted to change this so that the groups are no longer going vertically, but instead they're going horizontally, that's all of those different items are sitting inside the items panel. So it'd be the items panel that I want to change in order to make that change. And so let me back up just so we can kind of get a bird's eye view of what's going on.
Can we just run this and show first?
Yeah, let's run this and show it.
Like.
Good idea. Good, before we go too far. Right. All right. I'm going to change what the default project is. Oh, man. All right, I can do it right here just by going right-clicking and saying Startup Project. Now, I hit Control F5, builds, deploys, and runs for me. So here's the zoomed in, which is the default view of the semantic zoom. And there are a couple of ways to do semantic zoom. The first way is with my finger. I can just pinch it, and it zooms out. And then I can stretch it, and it'll zoom back in. I can also use my mouse. By going down to the bottom right-hand corner, there's a little minus sign that allows me to zoom out and zoom back in as well. And then the last way to do it, or the second to the last way, there's another way too. Control mouse wheel can do it as well. It's actually the most fun way to do it. And then there's also, is it control minus, shift minus, control period? There's also a keystroke. Keystroke. There is a keystroke, but I don't remember what it is. But there is one, and... What? I know that I really thought it was control period. It doesn't matter. Okay, so now let's start using some of the binding capabilities in here.
Oh, you didn't do the horizontal part.
Oh yeah, let's do that. So I'll tell you one nice thing inside Blend is if I need to look at one grid view or the other, I don't have to actually zoom in or zoom out. I just change whichever one is selected inside the document outline here. So I'll go ahead and select the one that's down at the bottom, which is the zoomed out version. And so the easiest way to do that, I'll right click and say additional templates. In this case, it's the item panel. Just like you change the button template, I can change this one. I can't edit the current one. That's because it's the one that's injected by the system. But I can edit a copy or just an empty. Should I do copy or empty?
Empty.
I'm going to do empty. All right. So when I do, I want it to be right here. And I want it to be in this application as part of this grid view. It's the. It's not going to be something I'm going to reuse, so I have to scope really high. I'll say OK. And here it is, the items panel template. It's right there. And it's a stack panel. So the only property that I really want to change is it defaults to vertical, but I want to change that orientation so that it's horizontal instead. So I just go over to orientation. Here's the properties dialog. I'll just type orientation so I can find it. Currently it's vertical. I'll change that to be horizontal, and now they're nice and horizontal. I can see, I'll pop back up, I can see that they're a little too wide, right? They kind of hide each other. So real quickly, I'll just go in, make it a few edits more than I expected to here, but that's going to be great. All right, so I can see that I'll go to the grid itself, find its width, and change it not to be quite so wide, 480. Maybe it'll fit at 200. It will not fit. How about 250? Fits just fine. Now they go side by side. This is more of what you would expect to see. You know, you'd expect to see them back like that. If I was still not happy and I wanted to be side by, or you know, too tall and then kind of have two rows, I could use a different control instead of a simple stack panel. I could use a wrap grid and set that wrap grid to have a maximum number of rows in it.
The semantic zoom by keyboard should be control plus or control minus.
So I did know it right. I just, something I wasn't implementing correctly. Great, all right.
You always learn something, right?
That's right. All right, so this is all set. I'm gonna just do a quick control F5 again and see if everything looks the way we hope. There it is, back. Yeah, very nice. Oh, I still have a little bit of work I can see because of the selection. All right, so how would I fix that selection? I mean, this is what developers go through all the time. So I'll back up the hierarchy here, back to the grid view itself. It's because it's selecting the entire width, height of the grid view, which is unnecessarily stretched the entire way. So I can go to the layout here, and let me clear width, and go down to the layout section right here that talks about horizontal and vertical alignment. The vertical alignment is defaulted to stretch, which is great. Doesn't need to be. I can change it now to be centered, and now those selections will be limited more properly to the items inside it. So now I've got the way I want, and just to prove that it's true, I'll go ahead and run it one last time, and I can zoom back out, and when I go over them, you can see they're selected correctly. Now, I've got my stack, stack panel that's the issue, that has the scroll bar right here. I am going to not correct that.
That's
right now.
Okay. Because you can keep working on your UI.
That's
and
right. That's
finesse
right.
it further. And
there's
further
still a
further.
Lot I want to show off in different controls inside a store app. So the quickest solution would just be to shrink it a little.
We can ignore that. People can spend time like finessing their UI.
That's right. That's right. Okay. So let me go back to the view model inside Visual Studio. So I'll close Blend here, and. Wait, there we are. I'll close Blend. Refresh Visual Studio, go back to my view model, and remember, I only have a single property right now, and that's that observable collection. I'm going to create another property, and that's going to be the selected color. So I have another prop. Note is my next one. It's a property that implements notify property change. This is what developers write all the time. I do too. So it's going to be a color info, and it'll be called selected color. That means every time that this is written to, it raises an event that says property changed. Now, the reason it's saying set property right here and it's underlined is because it's trying to call to a method that doesn't exist. And so I like to use an abstract class called bindable base that it can inherit from. And so let me just also use my view model snippet, which includes the bindable base. So now I have this abstract class right here of bindable base. I'm going to go ahead and minimize it because it's very, very simple. It doesn't do anything. There's certainly no logic in it. Just implements this one this one interface. So up here, if I inherit from that base, which is bindable base, now this too has a... now this too implements it correctly. If I were to go down and say set property, it's not going to be underlined in red anymore. So that's a little bit of magic. I think it's at least worth just pointing out it implements this one property called property changed, which is required for iNotify property change, with two methods, one called set property, which just sets the property and then raises the event, and another one that's called raise property, and it just raises the property. It's just things that you type over and over, so I made a snippet of it. This is certainly the most common thing you would implement in a XAML solution, so that's certainly not magic.
By the way, the most common question in the chat window is the request to share your snippets on CodePlex as well.
My snippets? Oh! All right, sure, no problem. I'll do that. I'll add them to the project when I'm done. And all right, so we've added one more property. So the first one is the observable collection of groups, which we just used to create our semantic zoom. And then we have this selected. And so selected is nice because it allows us to choose which one is currently the user has selected. So let's go and do all of this inside Blend. Now that I have my model updated, I'll hit F6. And I'll right-click the main and say open in Blend. Probably didn't have to close Blend earlier, but that's all right. Here it is. Just takes a split second to open. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to bind the selected item of this grid view. And so this is the first, the zoomed in grid view in this case. Here's the zoomed in grid view right there. I'm going to bind its property of selected item. So there's a couple selection modes that you can use in a grid view. You can have none, where the user can't select any. And so you can see in the view here, one is already selected. And or you can have many, where they can select many of them. I don't want that. I only want to select one. That's the default, so I don't have to make a change. But I'll select the grid view. And one thing I want to find is the selected item. It's right here in the common group. And you know what I noticed? Command was moved to the common group out of the miscellaneous. Threw me for a loop for a little while. That was good. Here's selected item. You can see it's currently bound to the color. That's just because it's an individual item. It's not actually bound to the view model. So I'll say create data binding. You can see it already knows the context of my view model. There's that new property we created. So as soon as I bind it to that, it's set to it, except it will only read it. What I want to make sure is I go down here to more settings, and I can see that the binding direction is one way. I don't want it to be one way. I want it so that if anybody changes the view model, it updates my UI. That's one way. But I also want if anybody changes the UI, it updates my view model. That's two ways. So I'll go down to two ways. While I'm here, though, I will throw this one thing out for any store developer who might have missed this in Visual Studio 2012, that update source trigger is now available so I can select property change. That's a big deal, especially with text boxes, where as the user's typing different values, it's constantly updating the view model the way you want to. It used to be only when it had when it was blurred or it lost its focus, it would be updated. So now we can say update source trigger. Property changed. I'm not going to do that here because it doesn't matter. This is when the user does an actual selection operation. But I did want to point it out because I love it. All right. So now the change has been made. When the user makes a selection on this grid, the view model is updated for me. So I should be able to see that somehow. So I'll go up to the grid. This is the outermost grid of the entire page. And I want to set its background bound to the view model's value. Right, so I'll say the same thing as before. Right, I just click this little square right here. I'll go to create data binding. It sees the view model, of course, because it's still in context. And I'll bind it not to selected, but to the brush inside it. Right, I don't care about color info. That's not what a background gets set to. It does get set to a solid color brush. So I'll go ahead and do that. And you can see the color changed to transparent. That's because nothing is selected. So the default color is going to be transparent. So now let's just go ahead and prove that this works. I'll hit Control F5. It'll build, deploy, and run it for me. Now when I make a selection inside this grid, it will automatically change it for me like so. Right? Very nice. Very, very, very colorful app. Let's see. All right, so another control that was added to Windows 8.1 is the command bar. So we talked about doing the command bar. You built a simple one for us. I'm going to go ahead and build a simple one as well and see if we can add a button to it. So here's the bottom app bar. I will pin active container. That's absolutely not necessary at all. I'm going so fast, I'm just reading the menu. All right, let me pause and take a breath. Got it. All right, now I'm going to right-click bottom app bar, and I'm going to say add command bar. That's what I meant to do in the first place. So here's the command bar. You can see it down at the bottom. Very nice. I could drag things directly onto it, or I could right-click the primary commands and say add app bar button, and that's what I want to do. So here's the app bar button. It's created perfectly for me here, and whoops. There we are. And it's got the little smiley face. I'll jump to the properties of this button, like so. And, of course, you showed how we have this nice, rich fidelity to change it very, very easily. And its default here is driving me crazy. So this is going to be the recent button. Every time I change the color, I want to keep track of the colors. And so this will list all of the recent colors. So what's icon means recent? What icon means recent? Recent. Of course, this is very important to get just right since we're short on time. Well, I think the house does. Perfect. And I'll change it so it doesn't say app bar button as its text. It says recent. This button has no functionality at all right now, and so I'm going to drop back to Visual Studio and prepare for what it's going to do. All right, so here I am at Visual Studio. This is the view model that I'm in. I need another property, and this is going to be a list of colors, the last colors that I had. So here's another observable collection. Very important to make this one observable because I'll be reading and writing to it all the time. And so observable collection of color info, like so. And it'll be called recent. Every time that the selected property changes, it will add to the recent. So it won't do that by itself. I'm going to have to implement just a few lines of logic. I'll type it right here in front of you because what could possibly go wrong? So now, if recent contains value. All right, so now the color was just selected. That's what I have. I'm seeing whether or not recent already has that color that the user just selected. Because if they did, then there's no reason for me to add it to it, right? And I'll just say return. Otherwise, I want to say recent.addValue. Now the recent collection slowly grows in size until it has all the colors the user selected. Now the reality is some jerk of a user is probably going to select a million different items. I'm going to get an overflow because of it. So let me put a quick trim to make sure that I clear off recent. So I'll say, I'll say for each item in recent dot, we'll use take again, take five. This will make sure that only the top five items. Am I doing this right? I'm totally doing this right. Only the ones, the top five items are gone, so I can say recent.clear item. Now I'll remove the item I just inserted if I do it this way. So the only thing I need, not clear, remove. So the only thing I need to do is do a quick reverse here. So now I'm taking everything and reversing it and taking only the most recent ones and allowing them to stay on it. Ah, that's beautiful. Oh, I love that. That's so nice. All right, so simple enough. This is the setter. I haven't made any changes to the property fundamentally. The only thing is every time you set, every time you select a different color, it just adds it to the recent container or the recent collection. Make sense to you?
Yeah.
Makes sense to me too. All right, so how are we going to use that? I'm going to go back to blend here. And so blend hasn't really changed. I will go to my app bar button, and another property that I have inside my, another control that was given to me in Windows 8.1 is a flyout. So I can add a flyout now. So a flyout is great. You know, in 8.0 we had to create these flyouts by hand. Now these flyouts are sort of built for us, and they do all kinds of things that we would have had to have done all this coding around. So it's really great. So you can see the flyout pops up right above the button. That's because the placement of the flyout defaults to top, but I could make it to the left or the right, but I'm going to leave it right here at the top. And I'm going to make it just so it's in line to this button. I don't need to have it so it's reusable. So this is just a panel. It's just waiting for anything to be put inside it. You can see it over here more easily that when I open it up, it has a grid inside it. And what should I put inside that grid? Some way to be able to see the these recent items. So they click on this, and I don't have to worry about the click event or anything like that. As long as I have a flyout on a button, it automatically knows that when I click that button, it shows and reveals the flyout. So the grid here, I'm going to do a quick layout reset all here. So now I know it's going to be the size that I want. And inside that, I need some sort of repeater object. The base repeater object in all of XAML is items control. I don't want an items control. That's too much work. What I do want is maybe a list view. So I'll take list view. So the list view versus the grid view. We've used the grid view before. That's a horizontally oriented repeater of data. A list view is a vertically oriented repeater of data. So I'll go ahead and drag that down into the grid, just like that. And in it, I want it to be bound to that list of recent, right? So what I do is I'll go to the, here's the list view. I'll go to its properties. It has an item source. That's the thing that it's going to be repeating. So I'll go ahead and say create data binding. And if I had only built. Hang on just a second. I'll do a quick rebuild here. Do, 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 do. It's a good pause. I can take a drink. Drink of Mountain Dew, I'll add. All right, build succeeded. Now when I go to list view properties and I say item source, I can create a data binding, and it sees the recent observable collection, which is what I would want.
Yeah, you may want to clear out the properties in the list view as well, the layout properties.
Oh, did it have it as well?
Yeah.
No problem.
There we go.
All right, so now when I go to the list view, it's going to be bound automatically to it. And so when I click it, it should show me all the recent ones. So let's go ahead and give it a shot. I wonder if it'll work.
It will, Jerry. It will.
I like your confidence. I have it too. I think it'll be all right. All right, so here I am. I'll create a couple things for it to show. There's bisque, blue violet, brown. Now I'll right click in the open space, or I could have swiped up. There's recent. If I click on recent, it'll show the flyout, and then the list view inside it that doesn't have anything in recent. Here's list view. List view has item source. Let me make sure this binding is correct. It's bound to recent. Doesn't need a data template just to show something, right?
Let's debug the...
We're going to have to debug it. All right. Back to Visual Studio. Inside the main page, here is the setter. This is where it would be. So I'll go ahead and say breakpoint right there. Now if I hit F5, it'll do the same thing, only it'll attach to the debugger for me. All right, so the default one is that pink one. You can see the value, it's right there. It's gonna be that pale violet red. And then I can say F10, sets the value just fine. Recent, which is not null, doesn't contain, so it doesn't return. It adds it, and then for each one, take 5, that'll be 0 at the beginning.
That's the problem.
Skip 5. It's skip 5, Uni. I don't want to take 5. I want to skip them. You know, there's about 16 people out there watching. So it's like, Jerry, it's got to be skip. Skip 5 jumps and takes all the ones greater than 5. All right, there we go. There it is. I changed it to skip 5.
Folks in the chat channel caught your code without even debugging, man.
They're better than I am. Yeah. Were they narrating and clicking and typing the whole time? Because that's harder than you think. All right. So now I've selected a handful of them. Now when I click it, perfect. I can see that there are four of them. I'm going to need some sort of way of visualizing it. And so this kind of goes back to the scoped resources that you were talking about. I'll go in, and I can go into the list view itself. I'm going to say, right, I'm going to, you know what? I'd like to have some design time data here so I can kind of see what's going on. So up here in the constructor, I'll just add one more thing. I'll say for each, what can I do? I'll say for each